take my hand. Next, we're going to do the words of preparation. And I have to say that I say this every day I'm about to walk into the classroom. I need to say it every morning before we leave the house. But I say it every day, every class. May the words of my mouth
and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
First, I want to say thank you to Pastor Linda for inviting me to speak today to my Epworth Social Justice family. Thank you for embracing me and my family, my husband, my girls. I haven't been back here at a pulpit since 2010 when our father died. So I take this responsibility seriously. I stand here this morning on the shoulders of those who came before me to set the table. Today to honor an American hero, a Nobel Laureate for Peace, a black father, black hero of the Civil Rights Movement, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whose birthday was actually Friday and whose holiday we celebrate tomorrow on the 18th. As a child growing up in Brooklyn, I was 13 before I moved to Southern California. My sister and I, my brother was born yet, we were not allowed to watch TV. Instead, we had to read our books and do our schoolwork. With the exception of when Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was being honored on television, when Eyes on the Prize and Roots was on. That was the only time we did it. Our West Indian father and my African American mother were serious about two things, education and honoring Dr. King. And so the title, through much prayer, long prayer before we even went to Christmas break prayer, how do we turn away from anger towards hope, peace, love, and understanding that eventually leads to action? I want to say that the dream isn't fully realized yet. We're not beyond the dream because we still have racial injustice perpetrated against black people. Black Lives Matter movement is a response to these injustices, these daily, oftentimes hourly, tragedies and trespasses to our black humanity, to our humanity, to people in America, to black people in America. Dr. King wrote in 1962 at the Park Sheraton Hotel, "The unresolved race question is a pathological infection in our social and political anatomy, which has sickened us throughout history and still today is largely an untreated disease." 53 years later from the I Have a Dream speech, we are still faced with the manacle, he calls it, of segregation in terms of treatment of black people and the chains of discrimination. Yes, and poverty is still present. Sometimes you just get tired. Tired, because I'm tired. We should all be tired. Every person that's being killed, every black person who is a victim of racial discrimination, racial inequality, death by police brutality, and gun violence should be tired. We all should be tired. Or have we become just desensitized? Because there it is again, on the news, another brother or sister, another African American or black person person of African descent killed, beaten. Every time I go to work, I can guarantee you that I can look in the newspaper and find some example of racial discrimination and prejudice to use in my classroom. I teach it in my social class, I teach it in my stat class. I don't want to read it anymore. I'm still reading it. We're still reading it. We're still experiencing it. And so as I was thinking about this message, I went to Psalms 119, 28, because my soul melts with heaviness. And I know that those of us who believe in social justice, our souls need to melt with heaviness. We shouldn't have to see it again and again. So precious Lord, take my hand. Choked, killed, hit, beaten. I think I'm just tired of finding it. I'm tired of looking at it. So one afternoon, I went to my daughter's middle school recently and I'm helping the students prepare for the Black History Month celebration. And they want to create a play for Black History. They want to talk about these killings by police brutality and who they wanted to do and how they wanted to talk about it. So I said, okay, start looking it up. You know, that internet tool is wonderful. Because you can find anything, like, you know, Wikipedia. You know, you can find it. Social media, Snapchat, Twitter, Instagram. There are times when my daughters tell me what happened before I even get a chance to turn on my computer, because they've seen it. Then they started to create this list of names of those who died by police brutality. This list is like a list that we unfortunately have to take to the grocery store. You know that list you make, I gotta get milk, I gotta get butter, I gotta get cheese. They started to create this list of Black people, African Americans, people of African descent, who have been killed or suffered police brutality. Let's not forget Rodney King. Black lives matter because Amadou Diallo matters, 41 bullets. Patrick Dorsman, or Sammy Zongo, Timothy Stansberry, Sean Bell, who had 50 bullets put into him, and the officers were acquitted, Oscar Grant, Ayanna Jones, 7-year-old, who was killed by a SWAT team, oops, by mistake, James Craig Anderson, Kenneth Chamberlain Sr., Ramali Graham, Trayvon Martin, Rika Boyd, Jordan Davis, Timothy Russell named Melissa Williams, Tamon Robinson, Jonathan Farrell, Renish Bride, Kimani Gray, and that's just 2013. I haven't even gotten to 2014 yet. Dante Hamilton, Eric Gardner, John Crawford III, Michael Brown, Enzel Ford, Laquan McDonald, Tamir Rice, Plain. The list keeps going. Freddie Gray, Megan Hockaday, Walter Scott, Emmanuel Nine, Jonathan Sanders, Sandra Bland, Samuel DeBose, Jeremy McDonald, Corey Jones, Jamar Clark. And this is the short list. This isn't the long list. This is an exhaustive list. I didn't even want to look to see what we're seeing now, what's happening now in 2016. I just decided I'm just going to leave a question mark because I know when I teach on Tuesday in my source class, I'm going to have something, unfortunately, to talk about. Our young people have become aware. They have become these activists. The Black Lives Matter movement was formed by three young Black women in response to and result of the George Zimmerman's acquittal for the shooting death of an unarmed, hoodie-wearing teen, Trayvon Martin. The racist post in the library computer required a response of a walkout protest from Black high school students and allies, faculty, and the rest of the student body at Berkeley High here in our backyard. Takes me to Ephesians 4:26. You can be angry, but don't sin. I'm getting angry, but I can't do anything about it. I can't act. What do we do now? And every day that we're still living, still witnessing and reading and hearing about these acts of violence perpetrated on our black people in America. What do we do? Because guess what? We're getting cut, people are getting cut down almost like a shooting gallery. So much so that you can lose count if you're not awake and you're not aware. So I know I'm preaching to the choir here because we are a social justice church, but let me just say, when you don't have to worry or think about being followed in a department store, or ask for your ID when you write a check at the grocery store, or have someone clutch their purse when you sit down or walk by them, or change seats because they think your blackness will rub off, or not rent you an apartment because you are black when they see you, but when they talk to you on the phone, they thought you were white. That happened to me. Put that. Or when you see somebody homeless and you want to hand him some food, and he shouts, "Nigger," and walks away. When you don't have to worry about being pulled over in your car, or riddled with bullets, or when at the gas station you're trying to get gas and you're playing your music and you get shot because the music's too loud. Or you're dragged from your desk in the classroom because you won't put your cell phone away. Wearing a hoodie, get harassed, shot, arrested, beaten, riddled, and killed daily. When you don't have to think about that, then you can say, yes, all lives matter. If you don't have to think about your very existence, day in, day out, every single moment of your life, living in a state of heightened anxiety, of what Du Bois calls the double consciousness, then you don't understand, because you don't know, you don't understand the internal violence of the spirit that Dr. King talks about in the quote in our bulletin, that it does to you every day. So I look back and I wanted to say, how did Dr. King do it? How did he get up and march and walk? How did the movement do it day in and day out when you could see the lynchings, you could see people hanging from trees, you could see the death, you could see the dogs? So I looked at his letters from Birmingham jail in 1963. And he was there because of their ugly record of lynchings and beatings and bombings of black homes and churches. And so much so that it would blast your hope and make you deeply depressed and disappointed. Or as Dr. King had to explain to his six-year-old daughter that she couldn't go to the amusement park back then. Today, mothers and fathers and guardians and aunts and uncles have to tell their sons and daughters what to do, if you're black, with their hands, their body language, their tone of voice, if they encounter a police officer, just to stay alive. This trespass, this internal violence to our spirit. Unless you truly believe in your heart and understand that there are injustices perpetrated on black people more times than on our white counterparts, believe that it's wrong and protest with us because you want to be our allies for change, then you just can't understand why we're so angry. So I go back, what to do? What do we do about this anger? Because I really can't be too tired. We can't be too tired, because in the civil rights movement, they weren't too tired. My children got to, and Longfellow got to meet Joanne Bland. She was 11 years old when she marched with Dr. King in Selma over the Edmund Pettus Bridge. She was beaten and jailed 11 times at 13 years old, and she still got it. So I'm like, no, I can't be tired. I just need to know what to do. And so when I look back at his sermons and his speeches, all he says is walk in love. He says, through violence you may murder a murderer, but you can't murder. You may murder a liar, but you can't establish truth. You may murder a hater, but you can't murder hate. Darkness can't put out darkness, only light can. So I'm like, okay. So he talks more in his sermons. He talks about divine dissatisfaction. You know, we really need to study his sermons and his speeches and sit down and talk to one another about it, because there's so much to learn. He says we need to have divine dissatisfaction with the fact that our black brothers and sisters have been killed by police brutality or discriminated against. Everyone should be dissatisfied because of police brutality. We should be dissatisfied with the erosion of ethnic studies across college campuses, and at Berkeley High School, by the way, because they have a black studies program. Or in Arizona, when they've stripped it. We should be dissatisfied with economic and social inequality. So as I was reading, he said, know and assert, this is what he said our call to action is, know and assert our dignity of worth. Stand up to a system of racial injustice. Develop an unassailable and majestic sense of value. Black is beautiful. These are his words. Upset the cultural homicide. I was like, wow. Upset the cultural homicide. Don't let them take away, nullify, as Dr. King said, the contributions of black people in this country and in America and the coming future generations. What we can give to this country and what we've already given. He said, throw off the manacles of self-abnegation. Stand up and say, I'm somebody. I come from a rich history. I'm black, I'm beautiful, and I'm necessary. And then he says, use your economic and political power, because we're really not voiceless and powerless if we come together. You know, everybody's talking about this 2016 presidential campaign. Guess what? I don't know who they're polling. As they ask these questions, you know, what do you think about this person, that person, and Trump's numbers are up, and I don't know who they've talked to, because they didn't talk to me. I don't know if they've talked to you. I haven't seen it. I tell my students all the time, you know, you need to be inquisitive and question where they get that from, okay? Vote. Vote. Not only vote, but stand up against voter suppression, because there will be, again, this year. I can guarantee you that. And then he said, political power and economic power. Well, political power was the vote, but economic power. He called it economic withdrawal program. He said to hold on to your dollars. What if we really, as a community, held on to our dollars and said, we are not going to shop here. We are not going to buy this. We are not going to participate until there's change. Until there's change for everybody. Then he said Coca-Cola and Wonder Bread. I'm thinking, oh yeah, I remember Wonder Bread. You know, but what can we boycott our monies and put someplace else or in the black community today? Vote for measures that improve our schooling. Protest regentrification that's happening in Berkeley. And people are black people and people of color being displaced. Make sure young people are registered to vote, kind of like the bus boycott, sanitation workers. We just need to just do all these things that he did. We need to figure out how to apply it today and use it, because he gave us the template. And he didn't just get it out of a vacuum. He used the word. He used the Bible, basic instructions before leaving Earth. My brother told me that. He used it. He said, this is what you have to do. So he said, have a strong, demanding love in the face of hate. because hate is too great a burden to bear. He said, we need to find our highest good. Well, he went right back to the Bible and said, our highest good is in God because God is love. And love is nonviolent. Actually, love and power is nonviolent. If you really study power and love, we've kind of taken it and twisted this power and separated love, or have love and separated power. We really have to look at that. He says it in his writings. He says that God is love, and that can change the nature. Like they changed the gentleman who wrote Amazing Grace. You know, when I'm down and I'm kind of having my pity party depressed moment, I can turn on the gospel music for me, that's what works for me, and I can hear, I know I've been changed. Because the angels in heaven's then signed my name. Or Kirk Franklin's I Smile, even when I don't feel like it, I smile. Or Lord, what do you want me to do? And he says, and I ask him, order my steps. Tell me what to do, pick me up. I can feel that love power, that God love power, that love power that makes me want to abound in hope. That makes me want to have that confidence and that believing in God's promises, not what it looks like, but what we can do.
Amen.
He called it redemptive love. He got that from the Bible. We need to take that redemptive love and change one another. I do it in class every day. Somebody said, you can't change a racist mind. Put him in my classroom. When we talk about race for 2 weeks. And then at the end of my class, when we have to go back to capitalism, socialism, all that stuff, I ask my students, what was the best thing, what would you rather do more of, and what was the thing you didn't want to do? We loved race, we didn't want to stop talking about it, every semester. And that changes your attitude, your persona, your belief system. Even if it's a little bit, you've been exposed. You know, as God says, I planted you by the water. As long as I plant you, then I don't have to worry about the watering because God will take care of the rest. We need to go back to that. We need to walk in love. We need to break the chains of slavery. We need to love our enemies as hard as that sounds. We need to gain that love power because we're supposed to let our light shine in darkness, like it says in 2 Corinthians 4:6. So we still need to stand. Because Dr. King said, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Which means, as he said, your destiny is tied inextricably to black people's destiny, to our destiny. Change, we need change together. The civil rights movement created that change for the disability rights movement, for the LGBTQ movement. You gotta go back to where it started and change it. For us, for me who stands here, for our young people of color, and for all of us, because it affects all of us. Even when you don't think about it, it affects all of us.
Amen.
So, as I look back one more time, I mean, I was just doing sermons, and I noticed that with slavery, church bombings, lynchings, beatings, dog attacks, arrests, black killings, Dr. King kept marching, and the civil rights movement kept moving in the 60s. With the 16, 17, 18, 50 bullets riddling our young black men or imprisoning them in the new Jim Crow slavery, we need to continue to speak up in our classroom, in our homes, on our jobs, in our schools, in our streets, everywhere. We need to walk in love, though. He said nonviolent, so I'm going to work with his program, nonviolent. Because he said, the glory of the coming Lord. The glory of the Lord is coming if we stand up. Does your black life matter? for everybody in here who is black and of African descent, young people, stand up now. Because you matter. My girls, stand up. You are the future leaders. You are the ones that can continue this dream. Fulfill it with us. And for all of us who are allies in the Black Lives Matter movement, because we care about our black brothers and sisters, stand up. Don't let the difficulties turn you away. Because God is real. He's a God of hope. She's a God of hope. God will help you walk, stand, and love. Thank you.
Amen.